Hey grade 11s, my name is Carden Madzokere. Welcome to lesson number 55 from my textbook, The Distinction Bound Student, grade 11. Well, as usual, in this lesson, we're going to start by revising homework from the previous lesson. Okay, so it said the demand schedule for milk is given in the table below. So here we have the price of milk, and then we have the quantity demanded for milk at different points. So if you want to sort of understand a bit, you might want to draw a demand curve, okay? One that is downward sloping, and try to make some these numbers up, okay? So we are having milk at a price of 20, and then we also have it at the price of 15, okay? And so this will be your 20 and this will be your 15. By the way, this is not a requirement from what the question says. It doesn't really say draw a demand curve or anything like that. Okay, this will be your 90. Okay, and this will be your 100. All right, so this is our demand curve like that. Okay, just to have an understanding. Okay, so calculate the price elasticity of demand and determine the type of price elasticity. Okay, what you have to see here, well, what is going on here, the demand schedule for milk is given as below. Okay, so the initial price here is 15, so price goes up from 15 to 20, and then as a result, demand drops from 100 to 90. So what you have to find is what is the percentage, okay? Oh, sorry, not just change in. What the percentage change in quantity demanded divided by the percentage change in the price. Okay. So if we look at the quantity demand, so you must be careful what goes on top. Because let's say percentage change in quantity demanded is 4. I'm just saying, let's say. And percentage change in price, let's say it's 2. 4 divided by 2, the answer will be 2. Okay. However, what if you put the wrong one on top? You put 2 over 4. Okay. 4 into 2, it goes 0 point. 4 into 20, it goes 5 times. Okay. 4, 8, 12, 16, yes, 25 times. So the answer here is 0.5, the answer here is 2. So you need to be very careful what you put on top, because if you're not careful, the answer might be 2. And you come up with an answer of 0.5. So if your answer is wrong, then you are going to get the type of price elasticity wrong, because that which is between 0 and 1 is something else, and the one which is greater than 1 is also something else. So you need to be very, very careful. Okay, so let's have a look here. So if we want to calculate our percentage change in quantity demanded, we are going to see that our quantity demanded changed from 100 to 90. So it changed by negative 10, okay? It went down by 10. Then we could say 10 divided by that 100, which is the initial, times 100. Okay, this will give us the percentage change in quantity demanded. Okay, it's going to give me a negative 10, but this negative 10, I can ignore it and just write a 10%. Okay, there's a reason why I do it like this, or why it can be done like this. I'm going to explain it later on. Okay, then so I get my 10%. Then I'm going to calculate also price changed from 15 to 20, but this indicates an increase in price. Okay, but take note, it's coming from here to that, which turns out to be an increase. Okay, so if price goes up from 15 to 20, it means that it went up by 5. Okay, so that's 5 out of the previous one is 15, then we can say times 100. Okay, so 5 divided by 15 times 100, it will give you 33.3%. Okay, so the percentage change in price is 33.3%. Then now we simply say 10% divided by 33.3. Okay, so it's going to give us a 0.3. Okay, so basically that's it. This is the whole thing. And I think I was just being dramatic. 14 marks. I wonder how I calculated it, but 14 marks is too much for this. Maybe if you give 1 mark there, maybe 2 here, if not 1, another 1 here and 2 here, and that is it. And maybe the formula, 1 mark. So that will probably be 2, 4, 6, 8, 9. Okay, 9. Then it can't be 4% to determine which type of price elasticity it is. So this whole thing was supposed to be just 10 marks maybe. Okay, maybe I was just being dramatic. I don't know. Okay, it depends on what was going on that day. But basically, that's that. All right, so let's have a look. So there we have it. This is the 5. This 5 here is not 5%. This is just the change in price. And this negative 10 is the change in quantity. And for us to calculate price elasticity of demand, we say percentage change, not the quantity itself. Okay, so there we have some things, but ultimately it gives us this 0.3 that I got the other side. So the price elasticity of demand for milk is 0.3, which is less than 1. Therefore, in such a case, the demand for milk is relatively inelastic. The thing I was talking about at first was, if you say, I don't have my calculator here, if you were to say 33.3 divided by 10, oh yeah, I don't need 1, divided by 10, it will give you a 3.333, whatever. Okay, so a 3.3 will be greater than 1. So do you notice that in that case would then say, conclude and say, so it's relatively elastic. You see that? So if it's relatively elastic, the answer is wrong. Okay, so you'd get this one wrong. You also get this one wrong. So you must be careful what you put on top. So what goes on top? Even if we check there, the thing we wrote first was the change in price. And then the last thing that we wrote was the change in quantity demanded. So if you are not careful, you are going to put percentage change in price on top, which is the wrong formula. The formula say percentage change in quantity demanded divided by the percentage change in price. Okay, I don't usually spend time on homeworks. I usually want to jump into the lesson of the day. All right, so here is our lesson, price elasticity of supply. So price elasticity of supply is the same as price elasticity of demand. The only thing that is different here is we are only using a supply curve. So I'm not going to spend time in this lesson because it's the same thing that I did when I was teaching price elasticity of demand. Okay. So price elasticity of supply is a measure of the degree of change in the supplied amount of a commodity in response to the change in the commodity's price. So just like we say about price elasticity of demand, it's all about response. When price changes, how does quantity demanded respond? Okay. And the only thing, another thing that you're going to notice is just that demand is downward sloping and supply is upward sloping, mostly, I would say, because here you are going to see 5 degrees of elasticity, which 2 of them are 100% identical. So I'm going to help you see that. Okay, so in an exam, how would you know which is which? Like, how would you know this is price elasticity of demand and this is price elasticity of supply? I'm going to show you just now. Okay, so in other words, it can be defined as the rate of change in supply in response to a price change. So it is denoted by PES, which is price elasticity of supply, or ES. I normally use this one here. Okay, but you'll find some textbooks will say PES, which is price elasticity of supply. So when we are writing the formula, some would say PES is equal to percentage change in quantity demanded, in quantity supplied, divided by percentage change in price. I'd say ES is equal to. So basically we are saying the same thing. Okay. Right, how do we measure? I think I've said it already, but there are actually 2 measurements. We don't really use the geometric one in our syllabus, so we actually use the percentage one. Okay, So the geometric one, I'm just mentioning it in case you stumble across it and then you wonder how come this is not how we were taught. Well, in our syllabus, we use the percentage one, not the geometric one. So I'm not going to even talk about it. Okay. So according to this method, elasticity is measured in terms of the percentage, the rate of percentage change in quantity supplied to the percentage change in the price. So here's our formula here. In some cases, I'll write it as PES or ES. The formula then will be price elasticity of demand will be equal to percentage change in quantity demand supplied. You see, I'm used to demand it, but supplied, yes, divided by the percentage change in quantity in price. Okay, so it will be something like this in short, percentage change in quantity supplied divided by percentage change in price. Okay, that looks like a zero, but you know what it is. Okay, so there's our formula there. So the calculation of elasticity of supply is comparable to the calculation of elasticity of demand, except that the quantities used refer to quantity supplied instead of quantity demanded. If you see, the difference is just this S, which in that other case is replaced by the D. So when you see the D, know that it's the formula for calculating price elasticity of demand. If you see the S, know that it's a formula for calculating price elasticity of supply. Okay. Now, what are the factors that influence the elasticity of supply? Include number one, the ability to switch to production of other goods. That's number one. Okay. How quick could one do that? The ability to go out of business. That's number two. The ability to use other resource inputs. And the amount of time available to respond to the price change. Okay, so these are factors that will affect elasticity. Some will make will cause price elasticity of supply to be, I'd say, relatively elastic. Some of these factors will cause relatively inelastic, and some unitary, and so on. Okay. So over a short period of time, firms may be able to increase output only slightly in response to an increase in price. Over a long period of time, however, the level of production can be adjusted greatly and production processes can be altered. Additional workers can be hired, more plants can be built, and so on. Therefore, elasticity of supply is expected to be greater over a long period of time than it could be over a short period of time. So we would expect the supply elasticity of wheat to be very high as farmers can easily switch land that is used for wheat over to other crops such as corn and soybeans. On the other hand, an oil refinery cannot easily switch into production, its production capacity over to another product. So low oil refining margins do not reduce the quantity supplied by very much. So due to high capital costs, higher refining margins do not necessarily induce much greater supply. So the supply elasticity for oil refining is fairly low. Okay. Here's an example here. A firm supplies 50 units of a commodity at 8 rand per unit. When the price rises to 11 rand, the firm increases its supply to 75 units. Here, price elasticity of supply can be measured as follows. So we use our formula PES, or price elasticity of supply, is equal to percentage change in quantity supplied divided by the percentage change in the price. So you then do the subtractions there. It changed from 50 units to 75 units, so it changed by 25 units. So that answer divided by 50, which is the initial, times 100. And then when it comes to the price changed from 8 to 11. So the difference between 8 and 11 is 3. So that 3 divided by 8 times 100. So what it's going to give you is 50 divided by 37.5. So these numbers, take note, we might not write, but this is a 50% change, and this is a 37.5% change. So, but we don't put the percentage signs, basically, yes. And so the price elasticity of supply in this case will be 1.33. So that number will tell us the degree to which, the elasticity is. In other words, I'm saying it will tell us whether it's perfectly elastic, perfectly inelastic, unitary, relatively, like that. Okay. So unlike price elasticity of demand, price elasticity of supply is always a positive number. And the reason is because of the relationship between price and quantity supplied. The relationship between price and quantity supplied is positive, and the relationship between price and quantity demanded is inverse. In other words, when price goes up, demand goes down. But in this case, when price goes up, supply goes up. So for that reason, it will always be positive. Remember that negative that I got in the activity, I said I'm going to ignore it. And the reason was that, okay, it doesn't mean anything, okay? So this has brought us to the end of our lesson. As usual, we end our lessons with some homework. So yes, go and go through this. Let me see. Assume the price of corn rises by 20%. So here it's going to be easy. You don't have to go through that process. Yeah. And this causes supplies to increase the quantity of corn supplied by 40%. So again, as you do this activity, make sure you are careful what you put on top. Remember, it's percentage change in quantity supplied divided by percentage change in the price. Okay, so look which one is price and which one is quantity. But you can see here, price is the 20, so it's the one that goes down. And the percentage change in quantity supplied is 40%, so it's the one that goes on top. Okay, so calculate the price elasticity of supply. That's an easy one. In this case, is supply elastic or inelastic? Well, what tells you is the answer you get. Okay, it seems like we haven't done that when it comes to supply, but use your knowledge from demand. Okay, draw a correctly labeled graph of a supply curve illustrating the most extreme case. Okay, here we are giving you something else, like the most extreme case. We have two extreme cases, but take note of the category of elasticity you found in part B. What this question means is, if your answer for part B was the supply is elastic, then give us an extreme case for that, for being elastic. And if the answer was inelastic, then give us an extreme case for inelastic. I hope you understand that. Okay, the last one. What would likely be true of the availability of inputs for a firm with the supply curve you drew in part C? Then explain your answer. Okay, thank you so much. This has brought us to the end of our lesson. And as usual, like, subscribe, and invite a friend to this channel. Thank you so much.